Ladies and gentlemen, it's an almost pleasure to welcome to the Polish Institute of International Affairs Minister of Foreign Affairs of Lithuania, Linkevičius, who has been here regularly, appeared in the Polish Institute of International Affairs, but it is the first time under my clock. So it is an almost pleasure that I have this privilege and opportunity to welcome Sir here in this institution very warmly. However, outside, the weather is not particularly of that kind. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome all of you to this conversation with our friend, ally, neighbor, Minister of Foreign Affairs of Lithuania, a country with which we share a lot, both in terms of history and in terms of political practice. Today is a very particular day. We all probably tend to think what may happen tomorrow, what may happen the day after tomorrow, and how this new reality, political reality, may shape our region. The topic of our conversation with Minister is security of our region, challenges and, I believe, also opportunities, how we could enhance this alliance, how we can make it more effective. It would be probably the subject of our exchanges. After this short welcome, I would like to give the floor to the minister and ask him to share. Just to switch off.
It works.
Yes, it works. To share with us some introductory remarks, how we should feel about current world and the challenges ahead of us.
Yes. Good afternoon. Also, very good to know how do you feel. I feel quite good. It's nice to be back to Warsaw. Also to this place, although it was not under your clock, but we are quite compatible clocks, I hope, as it's one of the reasons why I'm here, to compare notes, to talk about bilateral relations, to talk about European Union agenda, NATO agenda. It's a pity that our meeting with my colleague will overshadow inauguration of President-elect Trump, but but you know, you never know, so we'll try to do our best. But frankly, we really have much more challenges ahead, which are common challenges, and we have maybe some problems, but these problems are minor comparing to the tasks we have. And I would say that 2017, every year is interesting. We're always saying that it's not boring, it's difficult, it's challenging, but 2017 will be stress tests, I would say, to many issues. And we're using this term, stress tests, very often with regard to the nuclear power plant, which is built 40 kilometers from Vilnius, a bit more kilometers from Warsaw, but in violation of international law, security standards. But now I would apply this test to European Union strength, to Euro-Atlantic relations. And you know, comfort zone is over. Those who think that, maybe not here in Warsaw, not in Vilnius, but sometimes people living in Western Europe thinks that his life is comfortable, it's fine, it's okay, it's over. We have to be vigilant, we have to be, it's no need for panic, definitely, but no need to relax. And we have to understand that we should take leadership once, if we need to be, so to say, listened. And we should understand that it's not the only center of gravity what we are having. There are other centers of gravity. And the wait-and-see approach is not the best approach in this world. Be it European Union, be it our values, be it Euro-Atlantic environment, whatever. And frankly speaking, stress test to the our values because of the lack of leadership, I would say. That suggests you to think about that. It's not a big surprise, but I believe when it's lack of leadership, we have vacuum. And vacuum usually filled with something else. And that something else is populism, radicalism. And we can blame those who elected, those who were elected, but we should blame ourselves, I mean politicians, because we did something wrong. And when we say that there's a gap between institutions and politicians and people at large. This is true. And if people do not know what we are doing, the people do not understand what we are doing, and when they're taking part in the elections guided by emotions rather than rational arguments or arguments at all, this is a big disaster. And look what's happening around. It's erosion of democratic, I would say, tools. Because there are referendums when people voting not for the questions they asked for, but voting guided by the emotions, even against those who pose these questions, to punish governments, for instance. Or like to say, to take hostage some country like it was in Netherlands, with all respect to the democratic, so to say, order in this very, very important country, but the referendum on Ukraine was exactly that. It has nothing to do with democracy. When country was taken as a hostage to test law of referendum, which was quite fresh, and making big fuss in all European Union, which we hope we will somehow go out of that. But it's also a good example. Also, other referendums, the people not listening to arguments and doing some intuitional decisions, and then aftermaths trying to find out what happened. So, whom to blame? Again, those who are in charge, those who forgot that they should explain to people what they're doing, as I said, and motivate them. Will be a lot of tasks ahead. We're often talking about Russia. Maybe somebody from Russia here as well. Really, with all respect to Russians, first of all, I'd like to say it's a very decent nation. Very, 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 really, I know many Russians, I can speak Russian, but you know, what's going on now, it's really a disaster. And I'm always trying to say that Russia is not a superpower, but it's a super problem. Because of behavior, because of actions in neighborhood, because of attempts to redraw borders of Europe in 21st century, with a little price, by the way, and consequences. We are witnessing all of that. And country which is permanent member of United Nations Security Council, a council which deserved to stay on guard of peace order in the world, violating all possible rules, destroying world peace order in our eyes, with our passive, I would say, attendance sometimes. Why I'm saying this? Because there were some lessons before. We remember war in South Caucasus, 2008. We remember reaction of Western community, very sharp and clear and right statements, which were melted down quite soon, in a couple months ago, back to business as usual. So I'm not calling for aggressiveness. I'm calling for consistency, to respect our own decisions and to stand firm when we need to conduct relations between countries based on values and principles, not on self-invented rules of somebody. It's also very important. So coming back to 2008, there were lessons learned by some who did this aggression, not learned by others, and it was a repetition in Crimea about what we were talking at that time, by the way. We have stationed in Donetsk, Lugansk, and I'm afraid if we'll be passive, we'll have events in Transnistria and elsewhere. And again, we'll ask how it happened, what we did wrong. So my point is, zone of comfort is over. We should be vigilant, we should take it very seriously, and we really should think twice before not doing, and we should understand that provocation is not if you're doing something right, if you're saying, stating something right. Provocation if you're not acting when you need to act. And I'm again talking not about escalation, by far, because our friends in the neighborhood are very gifted to swap sides, you know, and to accuse others what they are doing themselves. And now it's, I don't know your experience, but I'm having very many interviews with Western media, and very often I have a question, how we perceive that Russians taking response measures. They're simply responding to what NATO is doing. But when we're providing figures, numbers of troops, exercises, it's by far nothing to compare. And my point is that we are not competing, and we will not escalate the situation. We will not rock boat more than it is rocked now, but we have to take a clear stance. It's a matter of principle. If we'll have passive approach, we'll have more problems in the future. So not to prolong too much, my point is that Russia is an important factor. Unfortunately, it's not a partner now, it's a factor, should take into account, waste time and resources. Difficult to plan common views, but if we'll stand clear, consistent, we possibly will have normal dialogue in the future. Same with regard incoming, you mentioned administration of the United States. I'm not advocating and not downplaying. I'm also concerned about some statements. Definitely, regardless who will say what, the station is developing without our, so to say, presence. But let's not jump to any conclusion. New team is coming with goodwill. Definitely, I do not believe that these 4,000 plus officials to be appointed, approved by Congress, coming not out of the blue, they're coming from Republican pool, whom we know quite well, and they are predictable, and we know the values and views. They know Europe, they know your Atlantic, so to say, issues, everything. So I'm not downplaying, but I believe that it would be not right to think about U-turn, about dramatic change. Could be some corrections, but it's not possible to think about that. What we have to do, it's not professional, by the way, to be concerned or disappointed or frustrated. It's professional to focus and to do what we have to do. And we have to do a lot of things, to engage each other, to convince each other that our partnership is important for the sake of each other, not at the expense of each other, both sides of the ocean. And it has to do with economy, it has to do with the security, many things. If we will be passive, if we allow to destroy what was created during decades, it will be a big disaster, not only for your Atlantic community, but for world peace order, I would say, for everything what was created. Do we wish that? Probably not. Can we expect that? I hope also not. But this is not a given, as everything is not a given these days. Freedom, security, unity, nothing is given. And those who think that they can passively wait and see, this is too comfortable approach. Wait and see is over. We should be proactive. And that's also the case. And you know, usually it's more comfortable, wait and see, defensive agenda, reactive, so to say, activity. Name it, the area, propaganda, information war. We are not in the war, thanks God, as we speak here, but we are in the information war as we speak. And my point is, maybe you can disagree with me, we're losing this war, although we're capable to win, because we just underestimated the importance, relevance. Also, I have in mind resources, not only efforts. But this big, big deal. When you're brainwashing people, literally speaking, how you can rely on motivation, support, and whatever, so you have effect. And again, lack of resilience, lack of leadership, and this vacuum filled with radicals and populists, you know what I'm talking about. And now we see the situation is not yet over, it's developing. So 2017, that's my message before. Questions will be asked, really crucial, in whatever capacity we are we members of government, are we journalists, are we politologists, or just active citizens, we have to realize, we should do our part in order to really preserve what was creative, in order to do what we have to do, to be accountable to ourselves, first of all, and definitely to our societies. And here I'm coming to the importance of regional cooperation, of Lithuanian-Polish cooperation. You know, it's obvious, as I said, maybe we have some problems, but we are much more in common, much more important, much more global, where we can play a role, regardless of our size. We must contribute to the discussion with regard to Eastern Partnership. Again, openly speaking, not too many voices in here, but in my view, this is a litmus test of our efficiency. It's a litmus test of our credibility. It's easy to talk about values, about the right to choose, security alliances, but it's worthless if it's not defended, if it's not happening in reality, in the real life. And we see the precedents. So if we'll come to the point that will be another agreements guided by interests, not values, do I need to say that this is really a disaster? Do we need another Yalta, another something? Of course not. But it's not a given. Everything is not a given. We must fight for that. So we have good potential to continue in the better spirit and motivation. We must use this opportunity, and we cannot skip that opportunity. It's also very important. I really prefer usually to discuss rather than talk. I believe I did, as you wished, not too long.
So, perfect, please. Minister. Please sit down, please. And
thank you very much for this warm-up to our discussion here. I would like to ask first two questions, then I open the floor to our honorable guests. First of all, I would like to explain you why I'm wearing this blue flower here. It's important for Lithuanians symbol. They wear this flower, which is called "Forgive Me Not," "Forget Me Not," "Nie zapominajka," to remember the day when the crucial day of Lithuanian independence, 10th in January 1921, when 14 Lithuanians paid the highest price for Lithuanian independence. And I learned about this very powerful symbol a week ago when I participated in the snow meeting, which is being explained security now meeting in Lithuania. And I decided to wear this symbol just to emphasize that we share our historical experience with imperialism, and we benefited a lot from the collapse of Soviet Union and the end of the imperial phase of Soviet history. This leads me to the question to you, Minister, because you emphasized the term consistency, that we need to be patient and we have to be consistent. The trouble is that in the United States, every new administration comes with a new approach. It was a famous slogan during the first days of George W. Bush administration, who coined the term "everything but Clinton." So to signal to the bureaucrats, you can tell me about all possible politics, but I policies, but I'm not going to continue something which was started by Bill Clinton. So the problem is with the consistency. We need it to face the challenges coming from the different places. But on the other hand, the change is a crucial moment in any democratic system. How we can manage these two elements, to be consistent facing our challenges and to embrace the change, which is very important in democratic politics?
Now, first of all, thank you for reminding, it sounds interesting, reminding this forget-me-not. It's really important, and that reminds me also one issue which I'd like to share with you, which is understandable to you. We are a generation, we are from the countries which still remember price of freedom. And we still know that this is not a given, this is something we need to fight for, to stand for, not knowing that it's for granted, even not knowing it will happen, and it's not everywhere the same. That's the point. So that's why there's the reason that some of our colleagues are too relaxed and thinking this is science fiction. Sorry, I'm taking a bit longer because to say that, as a good example, my personal example, I remember we were discussing all these issues of Eastern Partnership, of need to support our partners, knowing that it's difficult for them. But it was sometimes very difficult because colleagues from Western Europe saying, okay, maybe you're right, but you're too sensitive, you're too close to that region, and maybe you're wrong, probably. You should relax, calm down, everything is okay. And I remember after this disaster, they've got these lessons, but after this MH17, there was immediate change, and some colleagues was, you know, shock, what happened? Because events which were supposed to be like science fiction, as I said, or somewhere remote distance or not happening at all, they came to the family, each family of those who thought it's not true. And that was shock, eyes-opening exercise. And then I said, how many wake-up calls needed to wake up? It depends on personality, but we need to wake up when it's time to wake up. This is the point. And by the way, is it the lesson learned? I'll not go further, but just coming back to this forget-me-not. It's not just a symbol. It's something which is in the hearts, in the minds, in the memory. And we should share this experience, not dramatizing by far. Of course, not escalating, but reminding. Values should be defended, and it's not a given. Now coming to these consistency and continuity, it's always balance, you know, in the life. If you'll not refresh the view, if you not reset, let's use this terminology, if you not do something like that, it's very difficult to renew it. It was the reason why American people choose Donald Trump, because they were fed up of the same system, of the same, so to say, names. And they needed something new, although life was not so bad in the United States. But this trend to look for something new was stronger, and that explains the need for change. So change is needed. But here comes also predictability and continuity. And you know, especially in foreign politics, frankly, maybe sometimes you need reset or change in education system, maybe in healthcare, somewhere else. But in continuity in foreign policy and security, it's a value, if you agree. And why we value very much when government's changing, first statement is about continuity in foreign policy. And here you should have this continuity. I'm lucky to say that in Lithuania we have this experience since the very beginning of our independence. Poland has maybe own experience, but since I am present in the government almost since the very beginning, I remember early 90s when we were arguing almost literally on everything in our parliament. But we managed to find that the way for Euro-Atlantic integration is our way. And it was shared by all political parties, all spectrum, position, opposition. We signed agreement, I remember, law on national security at the beginning. It was early 90s. We started to take all leverages given to us to prepare our countries for Euro-Atlantic integration without any complaints and without any promises. What I'm saying now, maybe here is somebody from Georgia, I don't know, but I'm always saying, guys, you are promised to be members, you know. We never had it. I, as ambassador to NATO, was told many times by future allies, looking in the eyes, you're a good guy, your country also nice, and your freedom fight is impressive, but you'll never be a member of NATO. It was said to me many times before 2000. Can you imagine what kind of motivation could be to conduct reforms, to think about that? But it was not a single mind to give up, not a single thought to change something. So I'm telling to our friends in Georgia or somewhere else, guys, be patient, do your job, and when time comes, you should be ready. If time will come and you will not be ready, blame yourself. So same in our case. And this continuity, in our case, started in the early 90s. And now, again, some maybe nuances, but in general terms, I believe in every country it should be foreign and security policy should be a glue of society. You can have divisions, you can have quarrels, conflicts, but if you have conflicts in this area, that's a bad signal to the sovereignty of the country, to the stability, and you should take all efforts and all political parties should take responsibility to grant this continuity. So I can talk, as you can imagine, long about that. I'll not do that, but just I hope I answered your question.
Can I be a little bit more specific? Minister, what would be your argument in favor of continuation of our former administration of the United States? You would like to encourage Mr. Tillerson or other important advisors of Donald Trump to follow the path which was set in Warsaw during the NATO summit?
Yeah, first of all, I'll take freedom to contemplate loudly how I perceive the situation. Businessman Donald Trump was not involved in foreign politics, we all know. And during electoral campaign, he was busy with home politics, I don't know, social care, health care. Foreign policy was not so important. And he was definitely briefed. He was briefed about NATO. And as businessman, he asked how NATO works. And he was informed that the United States paying 70% plus of NATO bills. Of course, he was very angry and expressed his criticism in the way maybe was not very nice for us to hear, but he was right. to say that Europeans, you should take care about your security as well. United States has a lot to do at home, and frankly, that was the case. So, but my point is that he was not really in depth. He was briefed, but not informed. I'm not advocating, again, by far, definitely not. And the statements that NATO is obsolete, it's wrong. Obviously, it's wrong. It's proved by history. By the way, he added in the same sentence that NATO is important to him. But this was not in the titles of the articles because it sounds not very dramatic, so not interesting. Interesting first part. Let's take whole picture into account, I would suggest. And let's also listen what he said to the leaders of Europe, to NATO, when they talked with Secretary General of NATO, emphasized the importance of NATO. And also what people he selected for high-ranking position, including future, possibly, Secretary of State talking in Congress. If you can criticize what he said, I cannot. I cannot. He did everything right. So you can endlessly be suspicious. You can jump to any conclusions. It's not productive. I would repeat, this big team of people coming to the positions, I have no doubt majority, complete majority of them, they know what that means is because they're coming from the sources which were not just informed, we were dealing with these issues for decades. So to think that one day they would change or make a U-turn would be not realistic. Maybe I'm wrong, but I'm just thinking that. So time will come, administration will assume responsibilities, will be not just briefed but also informed, and by the way, in the regular way, including intelligence sources. And that will settle down. That's why my wish, my hope, maybe I'm wrong, time will show, but I'm just making these assumptions.
We all know that NAC meetings can be boring.
It depends.
Especially for Donald Trump, who hasn't had such an experience. How to make this first meeting with Donald Trump intriguing enough for new president?
There are some my colleagues from NAC. It depends, you know, sometimes when we have now 28 members and sometimes no ambassadors, very, very disciplined because implementing and fulfilling instructions from the capitals, and they must say everything, and that was this famous saying invented, I believe first George Robertson used that everything was said but not by everybody, so you know this. So everybody's saying because they have to write reports. Of course it's boring. It's not boring, it's mad. Believe me, I spent many years in NATO. And sometimes, you know, if you're meeting three times per day and having this tour de table about what you know by heart, everyone what will say, yes. And real businessmen, not necessarily Donald Trump, will be fed up of that immediately. I have no doubt. But it's not our task to entertain, you know. We have to engage. And frankly, this is... Maybe other organizations are a bit of... I'm not trying to criticize other organizations, but those I witnessed and experienced, NATO is very concrete. Because it's really difficult. I believe we'll find the way to engage, to inform, and also to interest.
My last question, and as I promise, I will open the floor for...
you can break your promises.
I try to stick to it. How to make Europe great again?
Again, it's not a given. We need leadership. It's easy to say, I know, but this is important. If leaders will be shying away from the responsibility, if leaders will wait until dark clouds of lies will come up and then start to dismiss and, you know, if leaders will create a reactive agenda rather to have this positive narrative, that will be Europe will not be great again. And that's the case, and frankly, not naming names, it's very difficult to talk about leadership, real leadership. I'm really very sad when sometimes we are too, so to say, I shouldn't say lazy, but sometimes waiting a lot and reacting too late, doing too little. This is also part of responsibility. And more to say, if there are conflicts taking place in many places in Europe, we cannot blame Europe, because Europe didn't invade Crimea or South Ossetia or Abkhazia. And Europe didn't make a mess in Syria, of course. But Europe must be an active player. And if Europe has leverages, resources, by the way, talking in the 28 countries, not a big deal, but this is a very rich club. And if we are not taking responsibility to try to solve these conflicts, we also should take accountability, frankly speaking. So we are not guilty for these events, but we are responsible. And if we will continue the same way, Europe will not be great again.
Do we need a new set of individuals at the top of EU institutions to lead Europe in the right direction?
Allow me not to comment concrete individuals. I know what your point
is. I'm not asking for names, of course.
Yeah, but it's general comment valid, what I said. Yeah, really, we need individuals, active leaders in the countries, in the institutions, able to lead, not to listen and to react, able just to provide own views and take initiative in the agenda, in the actions. And it's nothing to do, again, with the offensive. It has to do with the consistency, professional approach. I know, easy to say, but no one promised will be easy, so to say. It's difficult.
Ladies and gentlemen, promise should be kept. I open the floor for questions. Please be as brief as possible and introduce yourself at the beginning.
Yes. Hello, Povachowski, Ambassador of Australia to both Poland and Lithuania, very
we
proudly. Minister, yes, good to see you again. Thank you very much for your invitation, Panie Prezesie. My question is slightly provocative in the spirit of a Pana Prezesa question, and with apologies to any American and even Russian colleagues in the audience. Now, new administrations tend to want to start, like we said, you know, with resets, new dialogues. If it were that a dialogue was to be opened between US and Russia, what do you think Mr. Trump should ask for as a gesture of goodwill from Russia? Something that I have in mind is realistic, not withdraw from occupied Ukraine. We don't like that, but that's perhaps less likely to happen immediately. But in terms of maybe confidence or signals of seriousness of Russia's engagement, what are the three things you would ask Mr. Putin to ask Russia?
Before answering to your question directly, I would say my assumption, what Russia wants. Maybe I'm wrong, but I think using this opportunity, this period of uncertainty, this lack of leadership, this change of leadership in some countries and elections in some countries, given this situation, would be nice to try, in my view, right? To destroy current European security architecture. Or to start from scratch, as was said very, very often, without any commitments and obligations for the past. And some of our friends helping to do that, unfortunately, which is not right. We have to preserve what was created. There is international law. It should be respected. Law, not self-invented rules by somebody. Because if you agree, there is some temptation to have self-invented rules and ask or even plea others to respect, and this is not the way to go. So first point, destroy current architecture, which will be very, very unhelpful, I would say. Also, I would say task to neutralize NATO, to make sure that NATO will not be enlarged anymore, because it's no need, because of various arguments, or maybe to limit to the fights with terrorism, I would say, but to put this Article 5 somewhere far away, and not as the essential point. That would be also very important point to do. I believe legitimate what was done, Crimea, or other ambitions in the regional conflicts. Legitimate, because there are already voices, even from inside some countries, to give up Crimea, so to say. But that, can you imagine, that would be precedent that in 21st century you can use power, change borders, and everyone will be not happy but satisfied. That would be huge, so to say, mistake, big precedent for the future, and that's also possible to do. So after saying this, I can mention more, of course, but just knowing what they want to do, so it's not so important what you will be discussing, because you will be discussing, obviously, what is on the minds of everyone in the world. Terrorism, migration, you know, all these issues. But how you will discuss, guided by which, so to say, principles. And again, my hope and belief, it's not possible anymore, especially on behalf of United States, be it president or somebody else, to neglect value-based approach. I cannot imagine it would be shared by public at large or Congress. It's not possible. Also, President, I do not believe that Donald Trump, such a guy who thinks that values are not important, just interests. I really cannot believe. So how you will discuss, and if he will discuss from the principled position, it's okay. And the wish to have good relations, also good. But it shouldn't be at the expense of democracy, at the expense of rights of countries to choose the way to go. That's very important. It will start to speak for these countries what they must do, what they shouldn't do, what they can do. That will be end of our democratic order in general terms. And this is also obvious. So many aspects, and I believe that, again, too early to jump to the conclusion. Also, one more point, maybe I'm wrong, but psychologically it's obvious President Donald Trump, he's a winner, right? He doesn't like to lose, and definitely doesn't like to be cheated, I presume. Western leaders were cheated many, many times. So I don't know how many attempts possible to use to check his so to say ability to digest all that behavior. He said himself, if you remember last comments, I'm not quoting because I'm not registering, but he said, I'll try to have good relations until I will manage to do that or something like that. There are some caveats. We'll see how long it will last. Because he already receiving information, he see what's happening, he's trying to engage and have insight of the events around, and he's, according to the sources we have, I don't know, you have your own sources, I also have friends and colleagues who are not far away from his team, they all saying that he's decent, smart man. Of course, he's from different planet because he was not in politics, but it's not necessarily bad. We'll see. So, but you know, to say in advance that it will be wrong, everything will be destroyed, it's not responsible in my view. Without any advocating, any so to say, just my really very frank opinion shared with you.
Can you imagine, Minister, a situation when Lithuania and other countries of the region may have different policy towards certain important for us issues on Eastern Europe than the United States?
Of course, we are different countries. We have our own thinking. So therefore, how it's important to compare notes. Why we have to do that, Lithuania and Poland, we have to do. Why Nordic Baltic countries, you know, we have very... I have to say, maybe you know, but we have excellent cooperation, and some time ago we had format 5+3, because Nordic countries invited us to take part in the meetings, and now it's Nordic Baltic 8. It explains a lot, because we are the same family. We are not only cooperating, but integrating, and really comparing notes, ideas, and using this for the sake of organizations we belong. And it's like a bridge between European Union and NATO, because some of these countries of Nordic Baltic 8, members of both organizations, some of just European Union, some of just NATO. So in the same spirit, we are developing these policies, and it's possible will be some nuances, but I believe will be less nuances if we'll regular way discuss these issues. Also Nordic Baltic and Visegrad, we have these meetings from time to time, you know, why not? There are also meetings of these three C's as an initiative of your country. I'm always saying formats is interesting, but it shouldn't be tourism. All these formats must be filled with substance. If we'll have substance, let's say infrastructure, energy, security, let's talk. It's for sake of all. And we must use this in the future, definitely even more probably than before.
Piotr Szymański, Center for Eastern Studies, Minister, German troops will arrive to Lithuania soon, and these battalion-sized battle groups are being deployed, but you strive for more ground-based air defense presence and more naval presence. Can you tell us more about the state of the game regarding these two spheres?
Yeah, thank you for the question, very important, because it was on one hand alarms from the East that it's something happening very wrong. There are also critics saying that it's not sufficient, and everyone right to some extent, except for those who are making noise. Because, you know, one battalion in the country will not make a difference. It's very important politically, very important sign. Germans providing as a framework nation up to 600 soldiers is also kind of big size. But it's not just Germany, also Benelux countries, others. It's multinational response to the threat. That's politically a very important signal to show that we are together and we are taking care about security. But obviously, not only experts know that there are a lot of capability gaps, e-defense, intelligence, Air Forces also, so we are very grateful also to Poland, six times conducting air policing in Baltic states. But it's air policing, experts also know it's even not air defense, it's air policing. It's like policing in the streets, it's not army. You can prevent from hooliganism in the airspace, which is also happening. So those who are making noise, they're totally wrong, because it's nothing to do with any aggressiveness by numbers, by activity, by functions. But this is a step to the right direction, because we need to fill these gaps consistently to do minimum, but what is necessary to show not just resilience, but readiness to defend. And those are right who say that it's not enough. Definitely not enough, but this is a good way forward. And one of the tasks, by the way, of our engagement with new administration of the United States to make sure that what was decided in Wales and consequently in Warsaw will be continued and will be, so to say, gone the same direction. And that would be my comment. But gaps are existing, definitely, but it's not dramatic. We are on the good way. I'm personally very satisfied how decisions made in Warsaw being implemented. So we must grant to continue in the same spirit, and that would be okay.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. Ilgars Kleva, Ambassador of Latvia. Thank you, Mr. Minister, for your introduction and follow-up question, kind of, on defense issues. If I may ask, how it's more on defense, not on foreign affairs, but still foreign affairs involved, definitely. The chances for better coordination in terms of defense procurement issues among the Baltic states or Baltic states and Poland, how do you see it? Is it how realistic? Because nowadays, I mean, each country is developing its own development scheme and follow that plan and procure things, and then maybe we can have a better deals or even more efficient, so to say, way of doing things. And another thing, how do you think we have now this for years Baltic air policing, but in a longer perspective, do you think it would be realistic to think about our own air force? Let's say, maybe not national, but at least among three Baltic states, regionally, regional cooperation. Thank you.
Thank you. It was good to see you after a long time. You know, in my previous life, I was defense minister, seven years, so it's my passion, and thank you for the question. You know, first of all, there were always efforts to coordinate. It was not easy because always have different thinking. But of course, you're right. If you will manage to have some common procurement, it will be cheaper. It will be more competitive and not easy to say. But we have to try. I know there are, again, political will to do that. If our heads of states and defense, so to say, ministers will be in behind that, I believe we'll manage to do that. Baltic states, fine. If we can manage Baltic states and Poland and some other regional projects, even better. Difficult to say, but the answer is yes, not to prolong. Not only on procurement, on some other issues. We are very, so to say, proud, but small countries, and we meaning of our, so to say, entire, so to say, region is much better with regard to competitiveness and everything. So why we are very active Nordic Baltic? It's also becoming entity which is interesting as business partner, as development partner, and that's the case. On air policing is a bit different story because it happened that before wartime they had very strong air forces. At least in Lithuania, it was one of the strongest in Europe, by the way. But you know, as it ended up, sad to say, but the war showed that it was not even used properly. But now it's very sophisticated, very expensive, and it's possible theoretically to do. But I can tell you again, it's very easy to count others' money. But the fact is that air forces If you have air forces, you have to maintain. Pilots should fly. Flying hours are obligatory, otherwise they will lose their, so to say, professionalism. It's also very expensive. And there are many jets in European allies not in use. They should fly anyway. They should use and train their skills anyway. So whether they will do that at home, which is not so important, or they will do that in the areas where it is really important, it's a difference. And they can lose us from huge resources, which would swallow the biggest part of our small defense budget if we had our own, so to say, air force, even three of us, and will not be able to take part in the peace operations. At least Lithuania would not be able to lead PRT in Afghanistan, which we are very proud. We did that, I believe, in very good level. It was, believe me, not easy task, but if we would be tasked to have own air forces or by own tanks, for instance, logistics, everything, it's possible, but it would be not wise. Now I'm talking not from point of view of national, but of NATO point of view. And I remember our discussions in NATO time when Jim Jones, future national security advisor, but he was very smart as a secure, and he was very passionate when talking to the military commanders about air policing especially. He said, be wise, be smart, use properly. And we really can, this is the beauty of collective game. You really can find niche, you can develop quality, same as we did in Lithuania. When the first time I was appointed to defense minister, it was 93. We just created everything, you know, and it was obvious since very beginning that we will not impress anybody with numbers. So we have to choose some segment to do some quality. And one of the segments, for instance, was special forces. It's a brand of any army. I'm so proud that our special forces are very capable, popular, everywhere, everyone wants to cooperate, and this is done. So you do not need big numbers, but they are really efficient, professional. It's just example. So we have to do the same way all three Baltic states. Some capabilities could be combined, and some functions like procurement. But so there are our military commanders, they should think about that, definitely. But on air forces, I would be skeptical, not because I'm not patriot. Everyone would like to have national air forces. It's very, very expensive, and I doubt whether it will be very rational.
Paweł Cieplak, MFA of Poland. Minister, thank you very much for your visit. It's always a pleasure to host you in Warsaw. Very short question. After the last general election in Lithuania, there is a new government. What is your main political message? Message about the new political decision of the government.
It's easy to say because one of the first statements adopted by Parliament were statements about continuity of your Atlantic, of European policy, of NATO, of defense spendings, of relations with the United States. It was done in the very beginning, so no one should doubt that continuity, we use this terminology, is granted in this regard. So that's my answer. And I don't know what I have to add here.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. Director Dembski, Gorica Tanasova-Igorevska, Chargé d'Affaires of Republic of Macedonia to Poland, Lithuania, and Latvia. I would like to go back to the first question of consistency, but in regards to UN NATO membership and aspirations of the Western Balkan region, especially in light of the current challenges. Our countries and the countries on the Western Balkans route have shown that, you know, they can manage and they can be a very constructive partner, especially in dealing with issues like the migration file management. So what advice would you give us as the Western Balkans countries? I know that you're one of the biggest advocates, and thank you for that. And what arguments do you give your colleagues within the alliances and the union to keep up cheering basically for us until memberships? Thank you very much.
It's easy to give advices, you know, but I can say that we really still, our people, those who went through this process, even starting from difficult times, I already mentioned, they are still alive, so to say. It was recently. Use them. Use them. We're always saying, make full use. And the issues interesting for you, be it public diplomacy, be it concrete reform process, is it defense sector, security reform sector, or it's European Union, via twinning projects, for instance. We are very active in Balkans, very successful, I believe, including in Macedonia. I don't recall now, but it's also the case. It's very, very good bilateral track. Also, European resources, know-how. Practical, I would say, cooperation on the segments you will choose. Also, I would advise you to try to coordinate also your donors, because, again, from my experience in defense in 93, 94, I remember many friends were coming and very helpful, friendly, and everyone suggested to help. And we received, of course, all this assistance. Do you need this? Of course we need this. Do you need that? Yes, we need that. And then we realized we have 83 or so many types of vehicles in the armed forces, which is nightmare with regard to logistics. And then we decided we have to do something in that, you know, and we invented this Baltic Battalion project. I'll not go too far from that, but those who know, it's really excellent, I would say, model of multilateral cooperation, because there were receivers of assistance, three Baltic states, and donors were also coordinated their assistance. They decided themselves who is strong in which area. And for instance, Baltic Battalion itself was coordinated by Denmark. Airspace control project was situated in Lithuania, my native city, Kaunas, sponsored by the United States and coordinated by Norway. Navy cooperation was coordinated by Germany and situated in so to say, Estonia. Baltic Defense College as educational project was again sponsored by Denmark and situated in Tartu. And all of these projects still alive, I would say, in different capacity. Now they are part of NATO business and chain, but that showed how smart we all were. I'm proud, really. It was 93, 94, 95, and it's still alive in new capacity, because we not just coordinated ourselves, but also donors were coordinated. So I would suggest also to think about that and using your foreign contacts to find which country is stronger in which area, and to avoid the mess, and also to have this tangible and very concrete assistance in whatever field you feel. And how to do that, again, not to, so to say, be boring to the audience, just we really can help you more precisely what is our experience and know-how. It's applicable not only to Macedonia, to all countries in your region. And we would like to have all Western Balkans part of Euro-Atlantic family, if they wish so. That would be our so to say understanding, but again we will be ready to help in the issues which are of interest to you. Of course, we will not insist.
Andrzej Tovpik, I'm very glad you came to Warsaw, and it seems to me there is a time for very very important and useful talks between Lithuania and Poland. And Director Dombski mentioned at the beginning that we have a lot in common in our history. But usually we are referring to old history, but we have a lot in common in recent history. It reminds me when we cooperated very actively in joining both Lithuania and Poland, both NATO and the European Union, and it was very important cooperation. And your minister mentioned that there is a lack of leaders. But I would add also there is a lack of ideas, of programs, great programs. This is what we are lacking. We are in the period when the old programs, which we believe are so important for us, like European Union, NATO, are undermined or put in question. And my question is, what countries like Lithuania and Poland can do in this situation? Because usually we are observing what Russians and Americans are doing. But we are not asking ourselves what we can do in this situation. And it seems to me there is a lot of room for joint reflection. What could be the reaction of our countries and other countries like our two to react to present situation? It seems to me is a lacking. We are usually observing United States, Russia, but not we are observing ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you. First of all, Andrzej, very good to see you, definitely. And then you're quite right. But, you know, if there are no leaders, so there are no ideas. If there will be ideas, so they will be generated by somebody. And this somebody will be maybe smart people. So, and I agree with you. Big guys, they always making, so to say, well, the shape. And that's not bad that they're listening and trying to add maybe our efforts if something is rational. But where we have a privilege, we have more expertise in this region. We have really more fresh understanding about threats which are around. Really, by far, no, needless to explain, because we feel that, we know that, as I said already, we'll not repeat, price of freedom, we need what that means, motivation. We also know maybe our Eastern partners better, I believe. Really, it's cultural interaction, other reasons, maybe different languages and cultures and religions, but we can understand them better. And therefore, we can help them better. I'm convinced it will be, we you know, we are very gifted to have these slogans, Europe whole and free. Now, it's not used very often, but let's remind, it's not whole and not free. And it's applicable to the regions I'm talking. And are we doing something proactively in order to make a difference here? Sometimes very little. We can do that. It will not be easy, I already said. There are a few voices, not too many, but it doesn't mean that we should be passive. And these ideas or practical, it's our duty even, because if not, who else if not us, frankly? Nobody. If nobody, so we'll lose credibility of the organization, which talking about values, about principles, not defended or even left behind. This is really a big drama, I believe, for the future. And let's not hunt for high, so to say, tasks. Let's look in close neighborhood. We have a lot to do here, which is in coordination with our general tasks. So I agree with you. So let's generate ideas, both of us and our colleagues. Let's implement at least some of them. That would be something. That would be something for the beginning. And I'm convinced through cooperation of regional countries, all Lithuania and Poland, we can do a lot.
Thank you. I'm a deputy head of mission of the Embassy of Georgia. And I really wanted to thank Minister Linkevičius always mentioning Georgia when talking about wake-up calls. Unfortunately, that was not a wake-up call for everybody and everyone, the whole Europe. Just our partners like Lithuania, Poland, and many others, but not for everybody. My question is about security. Well, when it comes to eastern flanks, so we have some shapes already as a result of the ambitious decisions of the Warsaw Summit, so speaking about battalions and so on. But when it comes to countries like Georgia and Ukraine, for example, so what is an umbrella of our security? Do we fall under 360 degree approach, what was the main idea of the Warsaw Summit as main result, like projective stability? Because you mentioned, Minister, that we have a promise from NATO that one day we're going to become a member, and when this day comes, so we're going to be ready for that. And this is true, and we are doing our best. But on the other hand, don't you think that there is really need in Europe of an institutional umbrella? Because previously we had not institutional umbrella, but it was international values. It was international law. But today this is really ruined. Thank you.
I like Georgia very much, so I'm mentioning so often. I still believe that you do have a lot of leverages. And beat NATO, right? I'll repeat. We were never promised membership. We never had special commission with NATO. We never had any package, as you know, have now. at the same time, we also forced to have this membership action plan. But you remember yourself much better that even taxi drivers in Georgia knew what is membership action plan, which is a bureaucratic tool, basically. And nobody cared that this is promised in Bucharest that Georgia will be NATO member, which is also weird. So it has to do with public diplomacy. It's very important to inform public what is the essence. And the essence is that you have all political, so to say, promises in place in the documents, which will not be changed because it's already agreed language, as we bureaucrats saying. And the decision on membership will be political anyway. When? Difficult to say. You know, in our case, it was unexpectedly, but it was after 9/11, by the way. Maybe not all of you recalling, but after 9/11, it was like also a reset of mindset. And our big allies realized that it's important to fight with terrorists, regardless the size of the countries, regardless who they are, and those who were behind, they were important partners. And that was 2001, September, right? In 2002, President Bush came to our countries and also to Vilnius and said in Vilnius that those who will choose Lithuania as an enemy will make the enemy of the United States. And these words are in the plate on the city hall in Vilnius. I very much hope it will not be corrected. Yeah? but this is 2002, you know. In your case, I don't know what will be the reason, but time will come. I believe if you will not lose motivation, if you lose every tool. I know what you're talking, institutional umbrella, something else, but you're already implicitly creating your security environment every day, frankly. And you are not yet behind that, so to say, line, but you're already engaged, you're already involved, and not just Lithuania and Poland, many other countries are your friends. And really, I agree with you that this is fatigue of these enlargements. I also have to say that we are not credible enough. You deserve to have visa-free year before, I would say, because you fulfilled all criteria and all benchmarks were reached. Due to political reasons, it's delayed, but it will not be delayed forever. I hope and believe and have no doubt by springtime you will have it. So take any opportunity you have, step by step, increase your implicit and direct security guarantees, and time will come. So that's the only advice. I cannot say otherwise. So the biggest mistake now to lose, to retreat, to be disappointed, to look for some who is guilty. You can find easily who is guilty, but it's not rational. So continue the same way you're going, and friends will be not just standing by, but will be actively assisting you, same as other partners as well.
Thank you very much. Piotr Bajda, Institute of Political Science, Kardinal Wyszyński University in Warsaw. Minister, let me raise two questions to you. First, more academic and geopolitical. How can we define today Lithuania as a Northern European country or as a Central European one?
And superpower among Baltic states.
Thank you very much. It's perfect answer. And second, recently, we've observed some kind of tension between Minsk and Moscow. Do you think that we are able to accept some kind of new opening of bilateral Russian-Belarusian relations, or is just part of a political game addressed to wider audience? Thank you.
It's part of political game, it's part of geopolitical game, and factually, you know, those who know situation better, that Belarus is very, very much integrated with Russia. In security field, in military field, intelligence, border guarding, name it, everything. Even this nuclear power plant I mentioned is built according to Russian technology with Russian resources. It's also a Russian project, in fact, and everything is related. So we have to take into account. Although there are some nuances, and we all know these nuances. They, for instance, do not recognize, again, occupation of South Ossetia and Abkhazia, what we value very much. They are not very happy with Crimea. It's also true. They have some peculiarities with regard to deployment of Russian bases in the territory. And you know that we even public resistance to open the Air Force's base. At the same time, maybe there are other bases were opened, I don't know. So we shouldn't be naive. It's not something, but it's also something. But the trend is that this is, should be considered, practically speaking, as the same segment. It's different territory. It's sovereign country, but this is almost the same. So we should take this as a reality, which is becoming even more real. This reality in the future. How soon? I don't know. But this is true.
Justina Budgnaitė, Frölie Martin Luther University. Minister, thank you so much for being here. I would like to touch on energy security a little bit. Since we are talking about Lithuanian-Polish contribution on Euro-Atlantic security, could you maybe a bit elaborate on Lithuanian-Polish proactive role in this field? To what extent can we call Lithuania and Poland as policy shapers in energy security in NATO and in the EU? Thank you so much.
Minister, let me take yet another question, the last one.
Of course.
And yes.
Thank you very much. Natalia Slobodian, Kubiszewski Foundation. And thank you very much for your presentation and speech. And my question will be about energy diplomacy.
Energy
diplomacy. In your assessment, is it possible for Visegrad and Baltic states to present their energy interests in the European Commission as so-called as a one voice? Thank you.
Okay. Good questions, both about energy. I can tell that energy is really not just energy or economy, it's also sovereignty, it's also independence. You can be independent, you can belong to NATO, to European Union, but if you have single source of supplies, you will not be independent. You'll be blackmailed. And it reminds me of always saying this interesting cartoon I saw in some one of the European papers when it was parade in the Red Square. Troops were marching by this VIP tribune, tanks, missiles, you know, and Gazprom was carrying his pipe, the same military parade. So it says a lot, and we were dependent on single source too long, I would say. Now we are very happy and proud that end of 2014 we have the LNG terminal in our seaport, you probably know. The capacity is 4 BCM, it's much more than we need. We need 2.6 something nationally, so we easily can share with Latvians, with Estonians, what we are already doing with Estonians and also with Latvians. This is breakthrough in the region, even, not only in Lithuania. And here it comes to the importance to cooperate for regional countries. I'm really happy that we have electricity bridge with Poland. It's already working. We already signed the financial documents for European Union for the gas connections. So there's LNG terminal Nojusze. It's also LNG in Lithuania. Will be connections with gas storage in Čukalnis in Latvia, for instance. We'll have infrastructure. That's the case. In electricity, I'll come back, not just electricity bridge with Latvia, but also with Sweden, for all Baltic states. We're developing this infrastructure, but we need to, you know, synchronize. It's another task, and synchronization needs resources. I'm convinced it should be done via Poland, by the way. I hope we will do that, but it's not yet there, because the operator of our grid is in Moscow, or in Russia, so to say. So it's still dependent. And my point is that challenges are the same for all Baltic states, maybe Poland a little bit different, but also the same region. And we really can provide our own thinking. And we must do that, because in European Union, we're creating so-called energy union, you know. We developed very important rules, like third package, for instance. And we in Lithuania applied this among first, probably. It was not easy to do. But we see that some projects conducted in European Union, not in coordination with these rules, like not Nord Stream, for instance, just example, which not backed by any economic arguments. It could be backed by political arguments, but again, in odds with our policy, because it's just to skip Ukraine and to punish Ukraine, definitely speaking. It's not our policy, by the way, but it's done. So resources, money is very, very important in that. But having said this, it doesn't mean that we should not compare our noise and stand firm with the political position. And it could be, as energy diplomacy, you can call it whatever, but this could be really compatible, very strong, because we have some experience already behind and some challenges in the future which are common. and we should coordinate our steps. So that would be my comment to these two questions.
Thank you very much, Minister. I would like to, on behalf of the Institute and the audience, thank you for finding time to share with this Warsaw Foreign Affairs community your policy and your thoughts on the challenges ahead of us. I would like to thank very much Ambassador of Lithuania to Poland and his staff. They are great people. And they are doing great job.
They have no option.
Absolutely. We cooperate quite closely. There are at least two projects Polish Institute of International Affairs would be engaged in Polish-Lithuanian relations. It's an edition of Polish and Lithuanian diplomatic documents of interwar period in Polish to enhance the understanding of mutual relationship in this this time. And of course, the strategic dialogue. We are very much interested to continue that and to host our friends and experts in Poland soon, probably in the second half of the year. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking our minister for being with us.